Hey, this is Pete A.Turner from the Break It Down Show coming at you with an incredible episode today. Co-hosting with me today, of course, is best-selling author Scott Huesing. But check out who we got. So we know Billy Ray. Billy Ray writes the biggest Hollywood scripts. He just wrote the Terminator movie. They don't get bigger than that. And Billy said, make sure you guys talk to Gregg Hurwitz, and he was right. Gregg has published over 21 thrillers. He's an international bestseller, a New York Times number one bestseller. His books have been published in 32 languages. He's also written scripts for many of the major studios. He's written comic books for DC, for Marvel. He's also written political and cultural pieces trying to bridge the divide politically that we seem to have in this country. He's written pieces for Wall Street Journal, The Guardian. This guy knows no bounds when it comes to writing, and he's such a fantastic guy. He also, get this, he wrote his thesis, and Jordan Peterson was his advisor as an instructor. He's been on Dave Rubin. He's been on all of the big shows, and now he's on the Break It Down Show. We are super fortunate to have him. Okay, a couple things real quick. One, here's how you support us. Share the show. Subscribe. Have you heard the song and dance before? This is how you do it. We're going to put new t-shirts out in time for Christmas. You'll be able to support us that way. Sharing, liking, commenting, telling your friend, hey man, you got to check this out. One of the things I want you to realize too is we're doing this dance the last couple of shows where we had Matt Locke on, who's very conservative. Today, we're going to have on Gregg, who's more left-leaning. Both of these guys are reasonable, though. Then we're going to go back to the right a little bit and have Victor Davis Hanson tomorrow and his PhD brain break down what he calls the case for President Trump. And then we're going to go back the other direction. So we're going to spend some time just looking at how to be reasonable with what we hear and see in the media and have conversations about real problems. I hope you guys appreciate it. Would you also support Save the Brave if that's something that is if that's something that falls within your charitable charter? It's really super simple. SaveTheBrave.org. I don't mind it if you just give a few dollars a month. $5, $10, $50, $25, whatever it's going to be. SaveTheBrave.org. Click on donate. Go to the monthly subscription and click there. We'll put that money to great work. You can see it on the website. Go to either SaveTheBrave.org, our Facebook page, our Instagram page. You will see that we're getting these guys out, changing their dynamic, and literally saving lives. Suicide is rough for everybody. Help us help these guys. Just a little bit of extra money a month. All right, enough of me complaining and hollering and squeezing you for cash. Let's get to this show. I'm telling you, you're going to love it. I cannot get enough of Gregg Hurwitz. Oh, and one more thing. You can support Gregg by buying his latest book, Into the Fire, from the Orphan X series. This guy is gifted. You will love it. Buy his comic books. I'm telling you, you will love what he does. Thank you guys so much. I really love you and appreciate you.
Lions Rock Productions.
This is Jay Moore.
This is Greg Proops.
This is Jordan Harbinger.
This is Dexter from The Offspring.
This is Nathan East.
This is Sebastian Younger.
This is Rick Marotta.
This is Stuart Copeland.
This is Mick Gillette.
This is Andy Summers.
Hey, this is Skunk Baxter.
This is Gabby Reese.
This is Rob Bell.
Hey, this is John Leon Guerrero.
Hey, and this is Pete A.Turner.
Hey, this is Zachary Johnston. I'm a travel, food, and drink writer for Uproxx Life, and I'm here on the Break It Down Show today.
Hi there, this is Gregg Hurwitz, and you're listening to The Break It Down Show.
We met Gregg through Billy Ray, a mutual friend of Scott's and mine. He said, you guys got to talk to Gregg, and so we're up in the Hollywood Hills, and it's so nice. Oh, I can see Allie Willis's house from here. Do you know Allie Willis?
I don't know Allie Willis.
She wrote a ton of great songs. You know her work. She wrote a lot of songs with Earth, Wind & Fire. She wrote September and Boogie Wonderland and all kinds of songs. So anyhow, you're a writer of many things. Movies, books, screenplays, graphic novels, all that kind of thing. Everybody should check out your conversation with Dave Rubin, because that was an excellent podcast, and get a lot of background there. Scott's sitting on my right here. We're going to just probably dive in and sort of just freestyle, because you covered so much of your background in that episode. So let's just start off by saying the graphic novel world that you are into, you were talking on his show about being like Batman is like you're not really... I should say Marvel's more of your universe, but you love Batman as well. But we're all grown men, all nearly 50 years old.
Ostensibly.
Yeah, exactly. How do you play in that world and still stay relevant to the kids of today, those young minds from 40 years in our past who are grabbing these books?
It's a tightrope walk, really, because, you know, look, when I'm writing my own novels, I'm the creator. I'm the world builder, right?
Yeah.
So, and you know, the thriller series I've been working on the last 4 years is called Orphan X, and that's my own universe. When you go into comics, I always think of comics as like that rich kid who lived up the street from you who had all the best toys, and you could go there and play with all his toys that you couldn't necessarily afford as a kid.
Yeah.
That's what it's like playing with Marvel and DC. Like, you get to play with Batman. My favorite character growing up was the Punisher. I wrote the Punisher for Marvel.
Yeah.
It's amazing. And the tightrope walk that you're doing is that here's these characters who are archetypes. We all know where the parameters are for that. Like, you're not going to have Batman go in and kill a busload of nuns. Yeah, right? We know the outer limits of it. We know that if you step too far that my grandpa or my dad who read Batman or a kid is going to recognize that that's not Batman. But at the same time, they're bringing me in to have some kind of a voice to make it contemporary and to start to play with it a little bit. And so it's an interesting thing where I'm hired to do a Gregg Hurwitz version of a Batman story, but my name has to be secondary, right? My ego can't be in there to be like, I'm going to reinvent everything, right? So there's this balance that you're constantly finding. And one of the ways that I found it is with Batman having a little bit more of a self-awareness of what it means to be Batman. And so I played with a lot of humor at different times with it. And that's how that went.
Is your Batman a funny guy?
Yeah, he's self-aware.
Okay.
He's got a bit of sense of humor. But I'd say even more than that, my Batman universe is self-aware, and that's the way I made it contemporary. Like, for instance, I had one scene that wound up being one of the most popular things that I wrote. It was a little throwaway gag that he's in the office. You know, Commissioner Gordon comes back to his office. It's all dark at night. He says something, and voice issues from the shadows of the corner, and it's Batman, right? And Batman asks him some stuff. You know, Gordon's a bit startled. And then he says, and then Gordon, they have an exchange, and Gordon goes back and, you know, gazes gloomily out the window, and he's talking, and then he pauses. He goes, oh, this is the part where I turn around and you're not here anymore.
Hey, this is P.D. Turner from the Break It Down show, checking in real quick to ask you this. John, Scott, and I all support Save the Brave with our time, our location, our effort, and our money. Each month we give a small amount. Do the same with us. Go to savethebrave.org. Click on the donate tab, pick an amount that you want to come out each month, and they will handle all the rest. I stand behind these folks. Thank you so much. Let's get back to the show.
This is the part where I turn around and you're not here anymore. And then there's a voice comes from the shadows and goes, nope. And then they turn around and face each other. And it's like an awkward two dead panels of them just looking at each other awkwardly. And then Batman walks away. He's like, all right, then. And Jim's like, okay. And so it's like, it's playing with those notions of, we know this shtick, right? How do I write that scene for people who love those scenes, but also be aware that I'm talking to people who've read the scenes?
This is great. There's so many great things like this. I don't know if you remember, but for a while on the Cartoon Network, wherever Robot Chicken lived, maybe that was Comedy Central, all those shows did like a Star Wars week, and they did Star Wars based content. Mm. And one of them is Emperor Palpatine's on. This is like Star Wars, like Return of the Jedi area. No, wait, it's Return of the Jedi, where like the Death Star is not all the way done. And so the Emperor Palpatine's trying to be all evil, and he's screaming and he's mad. Meanwhile, there's contractors everywhere building his Death Star chip, you know, and he's like, ah, stop grinding. It's like these real life things that really
they're tapping
happen.
And being like, sir, did you want the Excelsior package with the plumbing system?
Right, exactly. Right. I got a problem. I'm going to have to, you know, whatever that thing is, right? And bring in these things that are certainly not evil incarnate. You know, they are norms. You also talked about.
Well, you know, it's so interesting. Yeah. I just figured out, and I never thought of this. In Orphan X, in my series that I've written, I drew upon certain stuff, certainly from Batman, from, you know, I've written a lot of thrillers. Mm. But when I got there, the thing that I did, because there's so many great characters, there's Jack Reacher and Jason Bourne and James Bond. I'm like, how do I make my guy unique? And how I made him, when I was thinking about where he could earn a place on the proverbial bookshelf, I thought, what if I take an archetypal character but put him in the real world with everyone else?
Yeah.
And so interesting that you raised that in this conversation, because the whole thing with him is he's Orphan X. He's this unbelievable badass, right? But then he comes home and like the elderly Jewish woman who lives in his building, who may or may not be based on my grandma, like grabs him into an HOA meeting and he's like bleeding in a knife cut. He has to cover it. And they're arguing over like the carpet pile density for the new carpeting in the hallways.
Mm-hmm.
And so I'm constantly doing that because it's the energy between these stories that we love, right? And the things that we strive toward, with also an awareness that we are grown men who have to live in the real world. You know, we do have to pause and interview and go open the door for my Ridgeback to come in, right? It doesn't get to all be artifice.
Yeah.
And I think that notion of authenticity is something that's so important. And I tried to, and I played with that with Batman to make it aware that it's real. And that's really the thrust of what I'm doing in my book series, which is where I'm spending, you know, the bulk of my time writing. It's all about that. He can perfectly calculate the overpressure charge from a demolition, right? From a breaching charge, let's say. But he's like undone if he has to make small talk at the mailbox. Like, he just doesn't know what to do. And it's about him learning how he has to enter the real world. And then all these real world complications that are so confusing. You never see James Bond go home. You never see Jason Bourne have an awkward encounter with a single mom who lives downstairs who he might have a crush on, and like they have all this energy, but he's trying to figure out what to do. Those are the things we never get to see.
Yeah.
And so my series is, I think it's a link between some of the fantasy kind of male hero stuff of my childhood and the things I had to learn about myself to function in the real world. How do you hold on to your masculinity and all those things that we strove for when we were younger, and also accommodate reality and the real world and real relationships and intimacy and the mess of human problems.
The comic fascinates me too, because I never grew up reading comics. I wasn't one of those kids. It just wasn't my thing. I didn't read, and this isn't a true confession, but I didn't read my first book cover to cover until I was enlisted in the Marine Corps. Overseas.
And
I
now just, you've written one.
Now I'm writing and people pay me to write. So it's irony or tragedy in some cases as a writer. But I didn't ever delve into the comic book. So I look at you now, walk in here, and I see, you know, anything from Stephen King to, you know, up here at the comic book shelf. When you're writing this and the humor that appeals mainly to adults, are you writing that in the comic book genre to adults? Are you thinking as your audience? Are you thinking of the kid that walks into the store and he goes, "Oh, I love Batman. He's my hero." Mm-hmm. Who do you write for?
It's interesting when you ask about the comics. I mean, I don't ever, if like ultimately I'm writing for myself, but I don't mean that preciously. Like, I don't have an awareness of how readers, right? People say that often and it's like, nah, you want to sell, you know, there's an audience. You're not going to be a dipshit and like write some artistic haiku version of something, you know? But really for me, I have to seed it in what feels the most real to me, what has the most meaning to me. And I have an eye towards it. Like, I know if I'm going to tilt too far and lose kids completely, right? But I also know if I'm writing and I'm dumbing it down to try and have it be commercial, I don't want to do that. Yeah. And so when I'm writing in my sweet spot, the hope is it will connect with everybody, that adults will find something in it. There's going to be kind of ironic humor. Think about, like, you know, a Pixar movie, right? Like, those are the dream movies. When you're a parent and you're going to the movies with kids and it's, you know, maybe it's like a really bad cartoon and, you know, when they're younger, and you're like, all right, I'll take one for the team. But those Pixar movies, everyone's lit up to go to.
Yeah, they become tolerable for adults to sit through. And yeah, it used to be the suffrage where you go and you're like, oh, I got to take my kid to this.
Right.
But when The Lion King came out, and then Pixar, and even the Lego movies are side-splitting funny.
And they're not, it's not even like we tolerate them. They're a delight.
Oh, they're great.
And so it's funny because with thrillers, people ask a lot, like, are you trying to be commercial or literary? And I'm like, I'm trying to be good. No one asks that about Alfred Hitchcock, right? Was Alfred Hitchcock of critical importance or was he commercial? And if you do the right thing, if you integrate and stay at the point that you're doing what you care about the most, it'll have a kind of appeal that's beyond you. And if I'm thinking ahead to the appeal, if I'm thinking too much ahead to the audiences, then I'm trying to construct something with the end in sight. And then it's not real writing, it's propaganda.
And then there is absolutely a market for that. There's a formula for that, for that certain writers love to do. But I like that you maintain your own style and your own voice and everything you do. And then I'm thinking about the writing process. I never in a million years would have thought about the comic books when you're writing this, and then you flip back, you're like, oh, did I go over the edge? And like the whole editing process for a comic book, I wouldn't think to edit a cell on a comic where, but you do, you go back and you make mods. And that's gotta be harder, because writing less is harder than writing more. I don't think there's any writer that would say being concise and getting.
Oh, it takes so much longer to write a shorter letter or email, right?
Yeah.
Especially if there's emotion to it. Like, think when you're mad or someone pisses you off and you're sending that email, you know, first draft is like 8 paragraphs, right?
Yeah.
And then you boil it down, you know, and you try and find the kernel of the thing that you feel. And there's so much more power in that and being succinct,
yes.
You know? Yeah. And so it's very similar that you want enough flourish and detail that readers are entering the world, that you carry them across the suspension of disbelief into your story. You make the story real to them. But one of the things I had to learn, I do a ton of research, right? I've gone with SEALs on the demolition ranges and blown up cars. I've gone up in stunt airplanes. I've gone undercover into mind control cults. I've swam with sharks. Like I do a lot of the stuff that's in the books.
Yeah.
I've trained really badly in mixed martial arts fighting, especially with Orphan X. Like I had to do a lot of research to be firsthand, which doesn't mean, which is not a signal for me being a badass. It means I went in rooms with people who were and was the worst person in those rooms so that I could learn and understand it, right? To write it. And my willingness to go there and do that is part of what makes those scenes real, right? I can give it a ring of verisimilitude. And what I used to do when I was younger is I'd do all this research and then I'd put it all in the book because I wanted to show off how much I knew, right? And what you learn eventually is, you know, a friend of mine had a great line. He said, your research slip is showing, right? Like when you're showy, because I'm like, hey, I didn't just go up in a stunt airplane and not give you every detail that I learned. And it's like, you don't go up, you don't do research to give every detail. You go to pick the right piece here and the right piece there that's going to tell the story. And that's part of what you're talking about, right? You got to boil it down. You have to find the right pieces.
Yeah, the airplane analogy is great. If you went and wrote about the entire pre-flight check and checking the fuel levels and content, no one wants that, because everything you learn as a writer from anybody that's been successful is you can't take everyone around every single corner. You take them from here to there, and it makes you feel that you have been there. At the end of the journey.
And how do you choose those things that are just the right thing
in the right
moment?
Luckily, you know, like you, I'm sure you surround yourself with smart people that when they read your stuff, they say, you know, it's either this is great or it needs work. And they're honest with you. I think that in anything you do, in any medium, having those people, you know, Billy Ray's one of those guys where he's accessible and he loves helping other people. I mean, I love giving him a shout out. There's just so many people. Sebastian was one of the guys. We shout him out on just about every episode because his name always seems to seep into everything we do. But what I like about what, you know, and for the listeners that are out there, I don't think they understand that a lot of these interviews that me and Pete do, they come from all these connections that have been on the Break It Down show. And then we show up, we drive, and we walk in someone's door. We're total strangers. But there's some sort of connection, and it's always through people. Mm-hmm. And people that have connected us in some great way. And when we were learning about you and doing our research on Gregg, the one thing I thought to myself is, here's a guy that hasn't pigeonholed himself. He falls into the broader category of artist. And a lot of people, especially in the fine art community, because you could say, oh, well, you're an artist, go paint me a watercolor. Mm-hmm. I wouldn't know how to paint you a watercolor because it's a completely different medium. And I think what you've done from the thriller series to comics to screenplays and everything you've done and studying Shakespeare and speaking on it, I mean, that's a pretty wide breadth of expertise. How did you come to want to create in so many different areas?
You know, one of the things I've been thinking a lot about lately, Steve Jobs gave that great commencement speech at Stanford, right? Where he talks about if you follow the things that you love, they don't make any sense. And then if you look back, there's a path that's illuminated.
Yeah.
And so it's like, I was obsessed with psychology and literature, right? I mean, Jordan Peterson was my thesis advisor when I was an undergrad, and I just gravitated to Carl Jung and to Freud. Well, Freud won the Nobel Prize in 1899 in literature, not psychology. Mm. People don't remember that. I think it was kind of an insult to him in a certain way because he was a scientist.
Right.
Those case studies are perfect short stories, right? And Carl Jung wrote about nothing but narrative, right? People are more familiar with Joseph Campbell, The Hero's Journey, but these are guys who wrote about writing and constructing storytelling. Mm-hmm. And so weirdly, people will say, why are you a thriller writer if you studied like Jungian analysis of Shakespearean tragedies? And it's like, well, what were Shakespearean tragedies? He wasn't high art. He's trying to sell out the Globe Theater. Yeah. He's trying to appeal to all sides of society. And every story that he took had a version of it in the past, except for The Tempest. The Tempest is the only thing that he wrote that was wholly unique. So, like, you know, Merchant of Venice is from The Jew of Malta, from, you know, a play that came earlier, and he made it better. And in writing genre, that's what we're doing, right? You have, you know, you have from Beowulf to Raymond Chandler with a lot in between. But then from Raymond Chandler, you have Robert B. Parker with Spencer for Hire. You have Mike Conley doing Harry Bosch, yeah. Right? You have, these aren't brand new stories no one's ever thought of, but you try to make them your own in a way. And that's what Shakespeare was doing. Shakespeare wrote very structured, narrative-driven tales of lust, intrigue, and murder. That's what I do. He has a psychological undercurrent to it that's staggering, that presages Freud probably and Jung. And so weirdly, as I do all, it's like, why am I in politics? I just went into politics because after I thought democracy would be okay without me. I thought it didn't need me to weigh in. And after 2016, you know, when I woke up in the wake of the election, I woke up not feeling a bunch of vitriol towards, you know, as a lifelong liberal, my more classically liberal than otherwise, I didn't wake up with vitriol for Donald Trump and for all the people who went there. I woke up thinking the first rule of anything is you look in the mirror. If you're going to fix anything in a relationship, any problem. And there's a lot of things about my party where I thought that they were missing the mark and had missed the mark. And so my reaction to try to enter politics was from that. But what I've been thinking a lot about lately, and your question's really interesting, is all these things sort of stack, right? They're all storytelling, obviously.
You nailed, yeah. That, I was thinking like, hey, Gregg, that was a genius pivot from being a writer to politics, because we were talking about it before the show, but I'm thinking in my head right now, I'm like, but it's all storytelling. It's all sharing a story, sharing a message in through whatever medium you can do it. And who's better at doing that than guys who write and can articulate that and what the message should be so everyone can understand it. That's genius. Yeah.
But look where our conversation's going here, just organically, right? Yeah. So I didn't think about politics in terms of how does this fit into my worldview of what I'm trying to accomplish. I just went and did it because that's where I was drawn. Like, you were drawn to write a book, having never finished a book cover to cover till the Marine Corps. Yep. Why were you drawn to do that? And when I think about it, if you look at our conversation, so here we start talking about comics and we're talking about authenticity in comics, right? Then I kind of realized, well, wait, in Orphan X, that's the whole thing that I'm doing. So what happened in 2016? 2016, we had a failure of anything that was overly curated in politics. The key word of the 2016 election was authenticity. Who was authentic? Who is authentically their truest self? Bernie Sanders and Donald Trump. One of the things I say about Trump is he lies all the time, but he's fundamentally honest. You know when he's angry, you know when he's flustered, you know when his ego is bruised. He's not checking polls. He's not figuring out how to react. You know, have I missed this moment in the Twitter news cycle? Let me check my polling group. And so authenticity came to the fore because people, I think, were so exhausted with, when's the last time you've turned on talking heads on Fox News, MSNBC, CNN, and somebody who's a representative from one side or the other said something wholly unexpected where you're like, I never thought of it that way. Every conversation is, you know, well, you know, do you think that this really hurts fill in the blank politician's chances? The person from that person's camp says absolutely not, and here's why. And the person from, like, everything is curated.
It's undigestible to me. I just cannot stomach the lack, really the lack of information that we get from mainstream media source is just painful. And that's why Pete and I love spreading ourselves thin. You know, we've gone to town halls on both sides of the hall. We meander in the apolitical spectrum, but we don't have a fear of diving in either and hearing other sides' positions on it, because I think that is the real thing.
Well, thank God, because either prove me wrong, teach me something I don't know, or vehemently be in disagreement with me, but if I pay attention, then I'll understand how to talk better to people who think the way you think.
Here's what's great about this discussion too, Gregg, is so, like, what, Monday, we're on with Matt Locke, who's a friend of mine down in Dallas. He used to be on this show called The Conservative Cartel, a show which you would probably never tune into just by the name. But the conversation we're having was very similar to this, is we want to create a forum or a platform or a discussion where everyone's included, and you don't have to bite everyone's head off just because they're affiliated with a certain party. but bring the narrative out into the public and have a discussion. And Billy's like that, Pete's like that, yeah. Matt's like that. And you can have a viewpoint, you can have a belief system, but you don't get crucified for it on national TV. And that's what's happening day in and day out. And I think I think as we move forward, we need more people like you that are willing to diverge into an area you don't feel comfortable about. I'm sure when you started writing your first story, you're like, well, I've never done this. Totally new to you.
Right.
But you did it.
If you do the thing that you love, because you'd asked me the question that started this little detour was, you were like, why are you so rangy? Like in all these different arenas. And what I realize is we're talking about authenticity and how you make comics appeal while still maintaining a set of values, mm-hmm. right? Archetypal, yeah. important, heroic values. That's what I'm doing in the Orphan X series. And that's what we're doing in politics. Weirdly, I didn't think of that, but I'm not interested in politics. Billy loves politics. Yeah. I do all this work in politics. I'm interested in psychology, decision-making, sociology, the cultural currents. And so I'm looking at these pressure points. And part of it for me is why I think I stumbled into politics, which I never thought of till now, is an awareness of how to bridge the gap between positive storytelling and authenticity of purpose. That's what all my writing is. And that's clearly like the bone I've been chewing on the last 5 years.
So what's the medium you're going to use to do that?
With politics?
Yeah, with politics.
Well, we do, you know, training of candidates, messaging on different issues, how you talk about issues from a non-sanctimonious perspective. We've done commercials. We've done presidential debate prep. Billy's done a ton of stump speeches.
Yeah.
We do events, but you know, we're on the phone with a lot of people to go, here's how, you know, do you want to merely signal how you feel about everything in a closed system? Or do you actually want to solve problems and discuss things in ways that are inclusive and bring in people with different perspectives to the conversation without a priori judging them for being morally deficient?
So simple, it might just work if people will subscribe to that channel. Yeah.
I want to jump in and talk a little bit about this thing, because you and I approach these problems in a very similar way. Even though I'm a combat spy, my job is to go do something totally different. My job is to bring back reality. You know, whether you're laying on a mat doing a bunch of martial arts with someone who's a black belt and you don't even have a belt. You know, you're just there kind of learning. But you're able to bring that reality.
I didn't have a belt to hold up my pants.
Right, exactly.
And I'm there getting my face introduced to the training mat continuously.
Right. But you sample that reality and you can bring it back. And this makes you sort of a liminal traveler and a cultural expert, because we talk a lot about EQ, but really CQ, cultural acuity, is really important, especially for politicians. Because when I see all of the Democratic presidential candidates, not all of them, most of them are legislators right now. And they can't solve legislative problems now while they're in Congress, but somehow they're going to do that at the executive, like outside of that branch. Mm. I don't understand that. Like, how are you going to create consensus? So what I'm looking for them is reality. Like, what? Help me understand. And don't just point at Mitch McConnell and blame him, because when you're president, you know who's still going to be running the Senate? Mitch McConnell. So these are big problems. You're trying to solve them. You're out sampling all these realities and communicating them back. Same thing I would do with the commander. This is what it's like to be in Afghanistan. You want to build a school? It's not as simple as that. Here's what it takes to do that. If you're on the left, you were raised by these people and they've given you these values. They don't have the same reality as me, Pete, in the middle, or, you know, Matt Locke, who's on the right. So you're trying to sample all these realities and bring them back, because you can't move these big bodies closer together without the other one understanding the other culture. So instead of having culture clash, you're trying to intersect and just get it to touch.
Well, and also when you go build a school in Afghanistan, if you go in and go, here's my training, here's my diagram, here's the roadmap.
Yeah.
This is how it will be. And I'm going to execute this. And you're not willing to update for ground truth. And you're not willing to update to say, who do I need to do? Do we got to bribe these guys? Do I have to, like, if your focus is on having the right answer and executing it, then it will stop you from the actual solution of getting it done the best way. But if you're open to constantly updating what the process is for something as complicated as trying to build a school in a war zone,
right,
then you can get it done. But you have to choose. Do you want to have all the answers and be executing this and enforcing it? Or do you actually want to get a school in place for kids? And if you want to do that, you have to be open to things, and you have to be open to knowing maybe half of your plan isn't going to work and isn't going to be effective. Maybe 90% of it. Maybe none of it is. And maybe, but if your goal isn't to execute and to display your expertise, which is virtue signaling, right? We do that all the time. Here's my views. It's a closed system. I'm a good person because I will signal that I hold these views, and people who don't are bad. For anything to get effectively done, you have to be open to figuring out all the ways that the reality dictates it. And if you're governed in your self-definition rather than the goal that you're seeking, which you need to signal an openness to truth to get, you can't solve the problem. So it's not just where you're putting your time and focus. It's what it's is it more important to you to be seen as somebody who holds a view or to get the outcome that you want? And one of the things Billy Marshall and I had a pretty effective run, you know, in terms of helping congresspeople, especially in, we only work with congresspeople in red districts, right? We work with 30 of them talking about how to discuss topics in ways that are more inclusive and can be more palatable to people with different value structures. Of the 30, we work with 22 won.
Yeah.
That's pretty effective. And I'm not saying we can take sole credit because those were spectacular candidates and a lot of other people did that. But I think it's fair to say that we played a role in all those things. And were we merely committed to wanting to signal everything that we'd figured out already? We can't get there. So what's the aim? And we drew fire. And one of the things that I said about this process was I said, part of why we were able to be effective in having, you know, three dipshit Hollywood typists, right, step into a political arena and actually have people listen to us is we asked for no money, no credit, and no permission. And if you don't need those three things, you can move the world.
Yeah.
Right? We're like, here's an idea. Take it. Let it be your chief of staffs, right? Here's this. Let that be yours. And anytime that we started to get tangled up in a bureaucracy or a system or a network, we're like, we'll build it our own. We're not going to, we can't go through and get 500 yeses because then it'll come out the way everything else has come out. We'll raise our own money. We'll shoot our own commercial. We'll write it. Marshall directed it. We'll produce it ourselves. Everything that we did was sort of outside if we ever hit a roadblock. And so, you know, that's a pretty good, but if we needed a ton of money and needed to be paid for all of it, that's tricky because then there are clients and we have to service them, right? Mm-hmm. And we can't say some of the hard truths maybe that people,
yes,
that's helpful,
yes,
right? If we want credit, then all the people themselves who've devoted their lives to it and their staff and all these people who are killing themselves, you know, will feel like their livelihood isn't making sense and their ideas, which form the bulk of the whole plan, are going to be denigrated or not going to be valued appropriately.
Yeah.
So it's like, here's a little piece, put into your bigger piece that's everything you've been doing. Take this stuff, just take it and use it. You know, so no money, no credit, no permission.
I don't think there's anything wrong with saying that you don't take any credit for what you're doing, but the fact that you just...
He said on a podcast, as we're talking about it.
No, but you're not taking credit for that. The fact that you're willing to give of your time, which is absolutely, especially as a guy that writes for a living, your time is your most valuable resource, and to give that away to really make an impact and to really make a difference, there's just not a lot of people willing to do that, brother. And the sheer fact that you're committed to doing that and you're passionate about it, the fact that you say, you know, we don't want any credit for it, is like that's apples and oranges with what you give them behind the curtain and then what you say right here in front of us. That struck me because the message is there should be more people willing to do it for free without credit and, you know, without, what was the third one?
Permission.
Absolutely.
You know, it's interesting.
That's a great message.
Yeah.
To the average.
Why have, you know, some of my closest friends are from the military and there's this real overlap. And it's pretty funny because I grew up in the San Francisco Bay Area, right? Like super liberal East Coast Jewish family. Like it's pretty opposite. And like one of my closest friends, you know, born again Christian, former Navy SEAL. And one of the things that is some of my favorite candidates, right? Like I'm doing this event for Alyssa Slotkin and Mikey Sherrill. Like you go into the candidates that when we've been able to recruit candidates from the military community, they're unbelievable. Right. Yeah. And I love McChrystal and Mattis and McRaven. Yeah. And like, they're just such kind of paragons. And the one thing that I realized that's so interesting is when you step outside that in a civilian life, when you talked about me being willing to do the work, or Billy, you know, Billy's up shooting a movie,
Canada,
busting
right
his ass.
Now, yeah.
You know, Marshall's got all kinds of...
I got an email from Billy yesterday about the next event while he's working his ass off.
But what's so interesting is if you're in the military,
Hey, this is P.A. Turner from Lions Rock Productions. We create podcasts around here. And if you, your brand, or your company want to figure out how to do a podcast, just talk to me. I'll give you the advice on the right gear, the best plan, and show you how to take a podcast that makes sense for you, that's sustainable, that's scalable, and fun. Hit me up at Pete@BreakItDownShow.com. Let me help. I want to hear about it.
But what's so interesting is if you're in the military, you know that you have to do the work.
Yeah.
And what's so interesting is outside it, everyone's like, well, what? Like, look at all this time that you're donating for no money or pro bono. And it's like, so let me get this straight. Everybody on both sides of the divide, I don't want to get into policy or platform or political sides.
Sure.
Everybody believes we're at an inflection point, right? Yeah. Like the republic's at stake one way or another. And yet they don't want to give any time. Like, think about the Revolutionary War, the Civil War, World War II.
Yeah.
Like, it used to be that unquestioningly people would come forth if you felt that those were the stakes. Well, we had a neighbor up the street here who, when Trump was elected, very liberal, said, you know, I can't deal with it. It's too ugly. We're moving to Canada. And unlike everyone else who made that claim, they actually moved to Canada.
Oh, shit.
And I remember I was talking to her and I just thought, thank God you weren't around when the Revolutionary War happened or when the civil rights movement
happened.
When real
shit was happening, yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
Like civil rights movement. We watch these movies and we read these books about people who went into the Deep South. My grandpa went in the Deep South to, you know, Jewish real estate attorney in New York and went down to defend African-American who were falsely accused of murder. Mm-hmm. They tried to run his car off a cliff. But somehow in this generation, we're excused from what we are deeming and calling a historical moment.
Well, you said it. I mean, again, this is like, you're totally on point with all of these things. The ground truth, you said that earlier, it's one of my driving principles. And the people that get out, don't ask for permission, don't ask for credit, just go do the goddamn work. You know, like we say that the military isn't a state building or a nation building platform. Well, then who the fuck is? State Department can't do it. There's not even a state to work on. You know, someone with big capacity, with a big footprint that you cannot move, has to do that work. So if it's not the military, then there is nobody to do that. So we have to accept that that chaos is going to continue and impact us way.
The military is a great organization to set the conditions for the right people to build those things up.
Right.
And people have heard me say this a ton of times. We're really great at breaking shit up. We're really bad about building shit up. That's not what the military does. We know absolutely we're good at. And when Pete joined me for a panel discussion with Carl Marlantis and Marjorie Eastman at Pacific Club titled Three Wars, one of the things I said unabashedly to a room full of probably, you know, Republican conservatives, I don't know what the demographic was, but, you know, hey, you better be cautious, because there was an empire called Rome that thought they'd be around forever too. 500 years. So the clock's ticking, America. We either come together as a nation and sort all this out, or we're going to start circling the drain pretty darn quick. Not in our lifetime, but our kids and their grandkids. I just think it's a really important discussion, and it always gets me very excited because I'm an emotional person, but I love when people care, and we were talking about this before the show, is like Gregg cares enough to give of your time, and that's really what it takes. So as you make an impact in the political arena, do you ever see yourself out more ingrained in the political arena? If people do trample you in, do you ever think
to actually
that?
Run?
Maybe.
No, I mean, look, we're doing a lot.
Stuff.
I mean,
look at Billy. He's doing Comey's movie right now in Canada.
I mean, you know, we'll see where it goes. I love writing. I mean, I love being a thriller writer. Can I go back to something you just said that tripped something? So I went out to what's the giant giant training base that they do the war simulations?
Twin Am Palms,
out in Vegas.
No,
out
it's
there?
On the way.
Fort Irwin.
Yes, Fort Irwin. Yeah, I went out to Fort Irwin, and you know, we did all the training, and I had this epiphany when I was, because they do a program for writers or producers. So they're like popping smoke, and we're crawling through. You know, it's the fake villages and. You know, you're going in tunnels between houses and they're doing stage stuff and we're shooting giant guns. And, you know, it was a big thing, big set of different research that they were doing. And I had this realization afterwards. They were talking and they do amazing, as you guys know, amazing stuff, right? They have their own social media network. They put a village market up and they hire real amputees and people from who speak Arabic so that you're inundated in a market and you're trying to watch stuff. And they have all the cultural sensitivity training there so that you can more effectively do nation building. And when they have a thing where if you come up with your ally when you're playing the war games and you take over a village and one of the local and the names of the countries are fictional, but one of your allies in the country, as you're giving an interview, shoot someone in the street behind you as a personal killing, as a vengeance killing. And then it catches fire on the fake social media. I mean, they build their whole own world to do this training.
Yeah, we have a guy that works up there. He's a good friend of our Johnny Walker, who wrote Codename Johnny Walker.
That's a hell of a name.
He's was embedded with SEALs, but he works at Fort Irwin as a contractor doing that.
So I'm sitting there, and they're having these conversations afterwards.
Sorry, he's American.
He's American.
He's an American citizen. The best American. Sorry, Johnny.
So what I realized was, and there's all these conversations about how do you deal with women in arrest? How do you deal with all this cultural sensitivity? And there's a woman speaking who's African-American. She was, I think, the first person to attain her particular rank who was talking about it. And I had this realization where I was like, oh, the military, we talk all the time about how are we going to integrate and update? How do we have... We're trying to get around Islamophobia. We're trying to get around gender inequality in the workplace. We're trying to talk about culture and sensitivity. And often the military is on the bad receiving end of that with the stories that are leaked.
Yeah.
But I had this epiphany of going, well, what's the largest community where they have to be aware of all these issues? I was blown away with the level of knowledge, cultural sensitivity, sensitivity for people from different religious backgrounds in the workplace, down to what MREs are able to be eaten if you're, you know, Muslim or Jewish, down to accommodations made for women. And I was thinking, how do we advance in our culture, right? We want more advancement, let's say, of people of color at higher ranks, and we want more sensitivity around certain issues, especially culturally, that have to be educated before you go into a country. And what is a giant organization that's doing that but cannot let go of its standards of excellence still? Yeah. So it has to happen.
In,
yeah.
Right.
Absolutely.
And what's so interesting is if you're just in a school, you can, like a university that's gone way off the pale to the far, far left.
Yeah.
Like Evergreen and that whole incident with Brett Weinstein.
So crazy.
You don't need to adhere to certain standards of absolute excellence because lives are at stake, right? And if you're in a different closed system that's like rabidly conservative, some like militia group wherever, you don't have to adhere to that either. But the great melting pot of America is best exemplified by, in some ways, and look, it's got its problems. I understand that. I'm not painting it with a broad brush. But to watch the way that people from all backgrounds and all demographics and all religions, right, and different genders are pulled together and are promoted in a way with increasing sensitivity towards a goal while having to maintain standards of community, right, while having to maintain standards of excellence, the best prototype for that I've sat in and watched, I realize, is the U.S. military.
It's true, and like, especially like in the tech companies, you think about them as being very progressive and inclusive, and you have this problem of, if your diversity divides, then you have a real problem. Because diversity and unity are opposites, right? So how do you blend diversity and unity? And the military is compelled to do that, where you have to have, like, all of those companies, all those tech companies.
That's where it doesn't mesh in the public when you're outside. Because we have to do that.
We have to.
You can't order Joe Public or Jane Public to do that in society. But you're absolutely right. As one of the smallest demographics in American society, less than 0.5% of the population, we go past race, gender, sexual orientation now, skin color. We don't see any of that because we only care about each other and taking care of each other to achieve the mission. And at the end of the day, it doesn't matter whether you're Native American or Black or Christian or Jewish or Muslim, we all bleed red. And on the battlefield, we do see things through a completely different lens.
Mm-hmm.
And you got a small dose of that at Fort Irwin. But, you know, for guys like Pete and me, we lived this for 24 years. And that's why we like taking those lessons learned, not just about military and walking around with a fucking rifle in your shoulder. It's about people. That is such a people business. And how we have gotten so much better at understanding culture, because understanding people and the cultures and the places we fight in, that makes us more effective at what we do, and it brings more Americans home alive when we have to go kick in doors and kill bad guys that need killing.
So that, I think that's beautifully stated. I have one amendment to what you said, where you were saying that we don't see like race or gender. And what's interesting is the slight amendment, because I know the spirit of what you meant, is that what was so interesting to me at Fort Irwin is it was really clear that there's the goal, the master goal that you're talking about, best training, excellence, save the most lives, and not just most American lives, right? How do you save the most lives if you're doing an invasion also? And so the diversity that is inherent and necessary is acknowledged and appreciated insofar as the new information that can be brought in. Mm. So it's like, okay, you're Muslim and you're a soldier. How do we make use of you and your knowledge? Like, how do we know, how do we understand that to have greater respect for that in a way that we can take in more information, but still it's folded under the same goal? And so the diversity is being used constantly as strength rather than division, right? Right. Like, what's a perspective if there's a female soldier and you're doing a door kick on a house and there's a bunch of women and children there, right? Like, she might know something that the men don't. And having those voices elevated.
I mean, you're lighting candles in my church, man, because we have talked about this ad nauseum, but it's such an important facet of leadership is understanding, like, if you have a soldier Marine in your unit and he's Muslim and he understands the culture and you just use him as a radio operator, you're not utilizing that capability. If you have females in your unit and they're the ones that can talk to females in a Muslim culture and they're the only ones, that's important because you're bringing all of those assets to bear. And that's what great leaders do. I wish I'd had more of them. We've talked extensively on my passion for female integration in the military, female roles in combat, and not bypassing 50% of the population. Until someone proves me wrong, says, hey, physiologically it just doesn't work, culturally it doesn't work. Until someone proves me wrong, I'm still gonna say organizationally, culturally as Americans, we have to move past that because we have 50% of our population who are females. And again, when we have a better understanding of cultural, gender roles and sex roles, man, we are gonna be, that's advancement as a nation, mm-hmm. as a military, as a nation, as a culture and society. It's gonna all bring us more success as a country, I think, in the long run.
So let me take this up to like the 20,000 foot view.
Talk more about amendments, because now it sounds like I have my own constitution. Now, like I like that amendment.
Well, so here's a bigger view of that we tend to forget, right? Like, so if you go and spend, you know, an hour on Twitter, in addition to wanting to take a bath after, what you're going to realize is that right now, if we're doing liberals and conservatives, the liberals think that the conservatives are wrong, immoral, culturally deficient, and should be obliterated, and vice versa. And what people don't realize is, and this is an outcropping of the conversation about using resources and diversity to the benefit of the overall community and the overall community goals, which is embedded in military values. When the military, right? Societally, the same thing holds true. Society functions the best when, if the more rabid and vehement elements of the far left, let's say that we're excluding that, and likewise of the far right, who want no compromise, take no quarters, everyone else is evil, and are just ossified ideologically, like they'll never move. The best version of a society is one where liberals and conservatives, with their different respective worldviews, are in concert with each other. If there's two healthy sides that are shaving the edges off each other, that are learning to look at things from different perspectives, that are having to reach a compromise, that's actually the most functional version politically and societally. I don't want an obliterated Republican Party. There's a lot. I am not a fan of this administration personally, and I'm looking at ways most specifically of how my side of the aisle needs to clean up in order to earn the trust of the people who don't think that my side of the aisle is worth their vote.
Yeah.
That's my focus. However, I want a robust, amazing Republican Party. I'd love to have a presidential ticket that I'm like, God, you know, I'm really thinking about it over there. Right. The stronger we can be. Yeah. And what's you know, I'll work on, I do some, you know, like we do think tank kind of informal think tanks now and then about different stuff with finances or politics to try and come up with different strategies and notions. One of the first things I'll do if there's a notion from something that is seemingly, let's say it's a notion that would fall on the liberal side of an approach, I'll call a friend who's a hardcore, like Wall Street conservative, hardcore libertarian, right? And just like, poke holes in this. Tell me everything that's annoying to you. Tell me everything that you think won't work.
Yeah.
Tell me everything that hits you wrong. And a lot of times there's really good points. And a lot of times I'm surprised at the differences. of the things that are palatable to them. Like where they're like, oh, that's actually a really cool idea.
Yeah.
But here's this other thing I really, that really grinds against me and my notions and values as a libertarian. Like, I don't want that piece. But if you do this piece and add this thing or look at that consideration and that willingness to be open, right? I mean, I think that's one of the biggest challenges if you're actually trying to walk towards meaning and effectiveness in life, in narrative, in politics, in your family, in a relationship. You have to maintain an openness, which involves the kind of strength to be able to be vulnerable, to have your ideas be vulnerable, to have your emotions be vulnerable, to have a constant level of humility that you're aware that people come in and they might poke you hard, but you might have something to learn. And if they're poking you hard enough that it hurts, instead of getting angry and you know, blasting out a big tweet storm, you stop and you think about it and you update it. And you might come down and go, you know what? I disagree with 90% of what you said, but based on the reaction I had, 10% of it's landing somewhere. And I got to go think about that.
Yeah.
Well, that's what you have to do.
Being vulnerable. I think that's, again, you were talking about your research slip show, and that's like your writer slip show. I was like, that's a tenet of being a good writer, is being vulnerable and exposing that. When you go advise politicians and candidates, how do you share that message about it's important to be vulnerable to make that human connection? Because as a politician or as a commander, you do have to wear a certain mask of command, a certain mask of leadership, so people don't view you as weak. Because I think a lot of the politicians don't want to be viewed as weak. And those two words, weakness and vulnerability, I think are confused at times.
That's right. They are.
In sincerity and authenticity, vulnerability. I think those are great tenets of leaders. And I just spoke to an entire group of Marines in St. Louis last weekend about that. And those aren't things we profess and teach guys in the textbook Professional Warriors read. How do you communicate that and give them some sort of balance? Like, it's all right to do this. Well, what's an example of advice you've given to them?
Well, it's so interesting and it's so specific. And a lot of that is the more intimate stuff that out of respect for them, I don't want to like trot out because it's a specific candidate that you might know and stuff that we're advising. But you said something amazing that I want to go back to. And I've never heard it stated that way, where you said there's a difference between weakness and vulnerability and people confuse the two. That's 100% right. And the thing is that we all realize, I think, if you're vulnerable, there is such a strength in being willing to be vulnerable. And if you're willing to be vulnerable in yourself, then you can't get hurt. And that feels like leadership. Mm-hmm. And in a weird way, it's like in the military, if you do something wrong, part of what the break you down to build you back up, part of that is it's like when you're a strong leader, the strongest shows of leadership, the ones that I most admire in people, I'm sure you see in the military, is when they do something wrong and they go, you know what? I screwed that up. I didn't see it right. You know, if you're the big showrunner in a room on a TV show and the lowly writer's assistant is like, you know what, this isn't landing for me. You can be like, you're the writer's assistant. What do you know? The biggest sign of leadership is to go, you know what? Best idea wins. Like, good on you. Good on you, kid. Right?
Yeah.
You just hit something that I didn't see. You're going to empower them. If you can own that, that's what real leadership is.
Yeah.
And it doesn't diminish your power. It enhances it. And so I think that's so much of what I'm talking about. When we get these angry defensive reactions, when we get the big cry bully defense, that's fake vulnerability, right? Yeah. The you know, you damaged me with this microaggression and I need an apology. It's a power play that disguises vulnerability. It's not real vulnerability. Real vulnerability is going, God, you know, I stepped that out. I opened myself up for a target. And someone hit me in the face really hard and they landed it, and good on them. Yeah. And I went out and I thought about it, and here's what I have to say in this presidential debate.
Well, having value in those on your team, I think, is a key tenet of leadership. But in the we're talking about that small microcosm of, you know, a writer or being a showrunner, but valuing that person's opinion in the political arena, I think what you hit on there too, Gregg, was really important, was there's so much infighting in each party that they will never get to that level. And the other aspect that a lot of people don't think of, and love or hate Trump, you gave him credit for emotion and being predictable to a degree. But here's another thing that guy is pretty good at. He plays the game. Mm-hmm. He knows the rules. He knows the things to say, when to say them. And to be great at the game, you have to know the rules. Michael Jordan wasn't, you know, hitting softballs in the offseason. He was shooting free throws because to be great at the game, yeah, you got to practice a sport. And I think that's what this guy does.
What I think Trump does is I think Trump plays his game. and his success is making everybody else, the Democrats, play his game.
Oh, yeah.
And the thing I keep saying is, if you want to beat him, play your own game, right?
I like that.
And so part of it is, if you're going to scramble, if he's going to tweet something that says that he knows is sticking his fist into a hornet's nest, yeah. and he says, go back to where you came from to four liberal Democratic women of color.
Yeah.
And if our response is to scramble and prove how not racist we are, we're playing his game, right? And yeah. then basically then Republicans look at Democrats and go, see, you don't care about real American issues. Yeah. You only care about proving a virtue signaling how non-racist you are, as opposed to someone stepping forth and going, guys, this is what I think is breaking the rules of the game and playing a different game. We know this game. Donald Trump tweets something that's vile. We scramble around and react of how good we are morally. But the thing is I'm not playing that game anymore.
Good.
Yeah.
I'm not giving that any attention. I'm going to talk right now instead about jobs and about stuff that actually people care about and to refuse to engage in that game. But as long as we're engaging in that game, he's going to keep playing it. He's going to keep poking. He's going to keep insulting
Baltimore.
He's good
at that game.
And he's good at the game. And if we're willing to be participants in that dance.
What is going to be the megaphone for the public, for the American society, to understand what the metrics of success are from either party? So they're doing all of these great things. The Democrats are doing things. Republicans are doing things. But none of that in the mainstream media is ever publicized. It's always about what they have not done. I wrote an op-ed
about this with Jordan Peterson for the Wall Street Journal about exactly this, about
why. What's the title?
Well, one of this, and I published a longer one on ThinkSpot. That's a social media platform that we launched. It's called "The Biggest Story in Politics That No One's Talking About." I might have changed the title for the abridged version for the Wall Street Journal.
We'll get it.
And essentially, the two things I would recommend around the political stuff that I've been doing that people read is that, and then there's a Vanity Fair profile of me, Marshall, and Billy that describes the approach that we've taken. I think those are two things to maybe throw up on the website or whatever with the podcast. But part of what I was talking about was, you know, the Democrats have passed dozens and dozens of bills, right? But if you go outside what's being reported, everyone says all they're talking about is impeachment, right? That's the only thing. Like, there's been bills to lower prescription drug prices. There's been bills on violent history checks. There's, you know, HR1 is an anti-corruption bill. There's election security. But the message isn't getting out in any way. And I said all that anybody is talking about, for different reasons, whether it's clickbait or business model, is, you know, AOC. Like, we know the headlines, we know the boogeymen. So when the Wall Street Journal ran the op-ed, they ran it with a picture of AOC, right? Yeah. When one of the big points that I was saying was, why isn't everyone talking about Haley Stevens in Michigan? Why isn't everyone talking about Kendra Horn in Oklahoma?
This is one of the big things about all of that is, like, yes, you have a squad of people that draw a lot of attention and have a big, huge Twitter following. But my congressperson, Katie Hill in my case, I don't want her doing that. I want her working.
That's right.
I want her on committees. If you're out talking to the press about things that aren't involved in your district, if you're trying to, as a freshman representative, if you're worried about Israeli national policy, you're not going to be my representative long. I'm not going to vote for that. I need you to help the people here. I live in Orange County.
We need roads. We need prescription drugs.
We need thousands of people that are living in the street and filth. And we need to figure out how to help those folks.
But again, do you actually want to help them, or do you want to signal what it is that your value set is so you can be adored
it? It's an exceptionally hard problem.
You and Billy, we talked about this too when we had him on the show. Was a lot of people say, oh, I don't want him as president. Okay, great. He's out tomorrow. Who's your guy?
Yeah.
Billy, right away, has an answer. This is who I want in there from Colorado. Yeah. I was like, boom.
Michael Bennett.
Michael Bennett. Yeah. And, you know, those are smart people. Those are people that are willing to put some skin in the game in to have the answers ready, not just hope for something. Hope isn't a course.
So what's interesting is Michael Bennett, who's spectacular.
Yeah.
I mean, the more you look him up and read about him, the more you, and I would guess a big swath of your listenership would really like him. And the question is do we want to choose and look at people who are really interesting and probably the right people, or do we want to follow the news stream of who's making the most outrageous statements?
We refuse to pick the best person.
Right.
And we make the job so shitty, the best people don't ever want it.
That's what we were talking about with Matt.
Yeah.
Even in the, like, conservative was, we just don't get enough great people to run. So there really is no
guaranteed selection. The next president is going to be constantly chasing, you know, impeachment talk.
Because conservatives in California are so tired of Feinstein winning every year, they're not putting up the right candidates, because as I'm looking at the at the ballot last year, I'm thinking, oh, I'd just love to, I'd love to check this guy because he's a veteran and like he's, man, he's gonna represent me so great. No. Like I did my research and I Google and I find out all I can. I'm, that guy's a whole bag of crazy. Like I just can't vote for that guy. So my choice is really, really hard. So until people are putting up and willing to,
hey, can,
I think on a bigger level, like you, like really, like say, you know what, this is gonna eat into my writing thrillers and making money in movies time. I think this is important because without a country, without security, I'm not going to have a room to write in.
Yeah, well, and also like when I'm on my deathbed, right, and everyone's like, well, what did you do when you believed that we were at an inflection point in history and that both parties were in need of a lot of work?
Yes.
And it's like, well, I tweeted. Yeah. I don't want that to be my answer.
And I wrote a comic book.
Right. I mean, and
I wrote a comic
I want to go back.
With some subtle political hints in there.
So you made that point about vulnerability. I want to go back to because it's really interesting about the difference between vulnerability and weakness. So here's a metaphor. So we've all been injured a lot, right? You know, for me, I was a pole vaulter in college. You guys, you know, your jobs mean that you're
Pete hurt my feelings on the way up to that.
That's true. Yeah. He made aggressive eye contact, which I'm getting some of right now. But you all know with an injury, right? We've all done rehab, stretching, like all, I would guess you guys have a host of injuries. And one of the things that you realize when you're really trying to rehab something is that the injury often, unless it's incredibly severe, the initial insult isn't always what the problem is, right? If you get hit by something, it's the muscles that seize up around it to protect it, right? And so like I had double hip surgery, not hip replacements, but it was significant, like legs pulled out of the socket, shaving down the head of the femur, it was a whole thing. And so I have to do a lot of work around them now to make sure that I'm going to have wheels, and it's gone really, really well. But part of the thing when I'm getting into it, whether it's, you know, stretching or lifting or any of those things, is you're trying to loosen up the muscles that are around the original injury, right? And if I don't do that, if I'm wasting a bunch of time in protection of what the original injury is. So let's say that the original injury is the point of vulnerability, okay? It's in my hips. If I don't pay attention to it, guess what? It goes to my knee. It goes to my ankle, right? It goes up. My neck starts hurting because my lower back's thrown out. And the inability to address and be willing to endure the pain of stretching the muscle and loosening the muscle around the injury to make the injury, to expose the injury to blood flow, right? To stretch down to it. And you've had that feeling. Everyone knows this who's throwing your back out, that part of when you're trying to stretch to get to your back is that feeling you have that your whole back's just going to go, but you're trying to stretch and get to it. I think that's the difference between vulnerability and weakness. I think if you have something that you know is a weak spot or a vulnerability in you, like let's say it's a view that you hold or a point that you're thinking is wrong or somewhere that you're in your confirmation bias, and people come at it, if you choose to firm around it and tighten your muscles around it, then you're going to take on another political view, and then you're going to counterpunch, and then you're going to do all this, and you get further and further away from that point of vulnerability and healing the point of vulnerability, right? And that's what I think we see so much politically. That's what we see so much where people are like, there's people who are sane people, pundits, friends that we have, who all of a sudden are advocating like insane far left or far right dynamics.
Yeah.
And you're like, how did you get there? And it's like, if you were just willing to look at certain things to tease it open, to allow more oxygen into your views, to amend it, to be aware of certain things in your thinking that might be off, you know, because then your whole worldview becomes ossified and hardened around protecting something. And then no one can kind of chip it.
Yeah. And you're not easy to work with.
Right.
You know, you can't collaborate with somebody who's not collaboratable. So when you're talking about a concept that I call miscomfort, it's not discomfort. Like you can get there, like you can work through that pain. Rodney Mullen, who's a skateboarder, you know, lower body was all screwed up from all his work as a skateboarder, and he had to go break down all those adhesions, and it was excruciating. Mm-hmm. But that was what he had to do to get to where he needed to get to, where he could skate at the highest level again. We had a guy who's 67 years old, ran a marathon on seven marathons on seven continents in 7 days. You don't get to do that by being afraid of some pain, you know, like you've just, the logistics of that sound painful.
We know so many guys like that, like Rob Jones, missing two legs.
Yeah.
30 days, 30 marathons. Like, who does right. that, man? Like,
that is where the growth is. And so, in general, like when we
that's
push
the pain, like getting pushing yeah. past the pain.
Like, this is just discomfort. It's not going to stop me from getting to where I'm going. So, like, when we push the whole register to vote and vote, fuck that. Your rights are way more valuable than just fucking voting. You know, you guys, you and Billy, you get out there, like, we're going to impact this at a much higher level. I'm going to get in front of the choice of A or B. I'm going to get involved way upstream. All of us, if we want to improve where we're at, we want to create unity, then get fucking involved. Don't just vote at the end.
That's a great analogy, though.
And so here's it. So let's carry the analogy out a little bit to how it might work in politics or mm-hmm. on a political view. Like, let's yeah. take the issue of abortion. Okay.
Ooh, nice.
Right. Let's just take something uncontroversial. Right. But let's say there's a viewpoint that you vehemently believe, as do I, in, and people are motivated by fear that that's going to get taken away, right? That the government's going to come in, they're going to go into your bedroom, but get between you and your wife or tell you what you have to do, right? There's a real yeah. fear there. And if that fear, rather than you understanding and sort of being able to take it in and sit with that discomfort, mm-hmm. leads you, I think one of the things that it leads you to do is to start to put forth a series of positions about abortion that are firmer because they're mm-hmm. counterpunches, right? And there's some examples of people saying some really callous stuff of like, you know, it's there's nothing to it. There was some joking for far left, super far left entertainers being like, getting an abortion was so trendy. I wish I'd gotten one in college. There's a lot of real callous
yeah.
talk around it, right? Or to say it's just a cluster of cells. It's no different than getting a birthmark removed or something like that. And those positions are so alienating because then the other side is like, if that's how you and that this is the I'm saying this is the extreme left. Sure. I'm not saying this is representative of the Democratic Party or where liberals are. But fair if enough. You take a position because you're unwilling to engage in the complexity and the depth of that choice and what it means, mm-hmm. you're going to harden yourself this way. And then other people are going to view the most hardened aspects of your view, conflate it with the whole party and push further the other way. Yeah. Right. You're all a bunch of crass murderers who don't care about anything. And the actual point of vulnerability, I think, is to say, look, I understand why for people this is an enormously difficult choice and has spiritual and psychological ramifications and emotional that they'll probably live with the rest of their lives.
Yeah.
And a lot of people do. It can be a horrible choice that carries with it a lot of trauma. You know, and with that said, and with respect for that position that people hold, and with me actually being willing to be open enough to give it its due, I still want to say that sometimes people only have two bad choices. And I think that the one thing I know is that I want to make that choice. Or if my, you know, a relative comes to me, a young niece who's been raped or sexually molested or doesn't want a pregnancy, that I don't, that's a horrible and difficult psychological, emotional choice that sure. I want to be centered with me. That's a position that is, you can disagree with it all you want, but I'm not going to a place of denigrating the opposition and simplifying my view on it because I have to be warrior hardened for any sort of view. And the willingness to sort of give, to steel man the opposition and even the opposition within ourselves to acknowledge the horrible complexity of that choice
yeah.
is actually what might make people say, maybe I can trust you to have a conversation about this then. Yeah. And maybe we'll still come out and disagree because of my views and because of the way I'm vehemently pro-life, but at least you are someone who's a good faith actor. At least you're somebody yeah. who's willing to engage in a real way. And the same thing, of course, happens in reverse, right? Where it's like, yep. you know, any, yeah, anyways.
So I'm trying to put the two, like the whole, the metaphor you use, but I think it's just the flexibility is that the last piece you were just talking about is like, that's a component of flexibility is, you know, I'm just trying to do the math here and, but it is. I mean, that's as extreme and as uncomfortable of an area that people want to get into when you're talking about female rights and abortion. Is like, man, you just can't get more.
Abortion's pretty simple in terms yeah. of if you look at. I don't even think about it in terms of choice. You're either for abortion or you're against it, and nobody owns the moral high ground. It's like being in a delta and claiming your little pile of sand is better than somebody else's because. Wait 20 minutes and you'll have a river going through your pile of sand. There's not going to be a good answer. We want to discuss when. Okay, great. Let's discuss when. But even that's hard. you know, because 8 months, that's too late. Like, that's an actual, babies are born at 8 months all the time, you know, so we've got to figure out what that. So if we come in with the position of, I know the right answer, there is only one, then you've already started with an undefendable position, because.
Well, leadership, you know, again.
Yeah.
Leadership needs to carry with it a proper amount of humility. You know, and it's funny because I've been bugged and overly dismissive of like all the stuff, like the anti-patriarchy. Like for me, I've been super dismissive, more so than I probably should be, about that kind of far left. Because it's like the patriarchy, and the patriarchy isn't just men, right? Mm-hmm. The patriarchy is also women who, like Hillary Clinton's part of the patriarchy, right? And one of the things that I realized is I was, you know, there's a lot of anger around it. And it's like, what does that even mean? And what does it even mean to people? And what's the point of it? And what's the world without a patriarchy? And how's anyone going to function without any kind of dominant hierarchy? And on and on and on.
Right.
But one of the things that I realized that I think is underlying the reasonable parts of those protests. I'm not talking about the crazy, you know, everything that I talk about, I'm dismissing 10% of the far left and 10% of the far right. Okay.
Right.
And one of the things I realized was that the concerns being conveyed in a language that doesn't land with me, like I'm not anti-patriarchy, that's not going to get me. But one of the things I realized was, let's just look at that being a fill-in for the dominant hierarchy. And I think one of the messages that's being conveyed in language that isn't, I had to think really long and hard to figure out a point of empathy with what might be beneath that view. And I think what it is, okay, you can have a dominant hierarchy. Right. And you can shuffle it all the way. And some people are going to do better and some people are going to do worse. Everybody knows that's the case. But if you're at the top and you're not going to rule and govern justly and with humility, and that gets too far out of whack, you're not doing your job well. And so I think that there's, you know, you better listen, you better pay attention. And that might be being expressed as like, tear down the patriarchy, tear everything down. And, that, you know, to me, that's just, that's imprecise talk, because I don't know what to do with that. And I think a lot of people don't. But I think that the lesson that's embedded in that for people who are upset is saying that there is a degree to which the people in power are not displaying sufficient humility in their views and concern for the people further down the dominance hierarchy. And if you look at what happened with you know, minority communities, white working class, like you go down the list of all the different categories that we can carve up into 50 different diverse groups. I don't think there's a lot of people who feel that things have been going spectacularly for people in the working class and below. And I think that's part of what's being said. And I think that's part of that's a value proposition that we can understand, whether you're where I sit politically or you sit, or your friend who you interviewed last week.
I think that stems solely from the perspective at which you view things. I mean, and the experiences you have. I mean, a lot of people, and Pete's heard me, you know, quote this before. I think it was H.R. McMaster said, you know, the people who normally have the most to say and the most opinions are usually the least informed. But also at a more macro level, at the political level, is the perspective is so different because they're so consumed with what they do and the message that has to get out that. The people that are affected at the bottom, they're the ones suffering.
Yeah. And that's part of the message. If we can just dismiss that as all sort of silliness.
Yeah.
Or we can really look at it and go, you know, Alyssa Slotkin tells a story about when she was on, she's in Michigan and she was 20 years CIA congresswoman. And she tells a story about a guy who she saw on an assembly line. I want to say it was at a Ford plant. And she was talking to him about politics and why do you vote for Trump? Because those are a lot of the voters that we need to earn their trust.
Right. You know,
especially people who voted for Obama and then Trump, right?
Yeah.
Not so easy to dismiss them as just racist.
Yeah. Oh.
And so she asked him about this. And the guy said, look, I got to tell you something. For 40 years, my life has been a straight line going down. I work harder and harder for less and less. Healthcare is more expensive. Prescription drugs are more expensive. It's harder to keep pace with it. My pay is not keeping up with inflation.
Yes.
He said, it doesn't matter if there's a Clinton in the White House, a Bush in the White House, Republicans, you know, Democrats. He said, I consider myself a stage 4 cancer victim and Trump was experimental chemo.
If
you think about that, no matter where you are in the political spectrum, that decision made and that sort of aspect of willing to blow things up and disrupt things, there is something that is courageous in that. And if we can understand that Let's say that we're Democrats. Let's say you're coming from my side where I don't think Trump was the best solution.
Right.
Personally.
Yeah.
But if I can understand that and I can really occupy and understand why that's a valid viewpoint, and I'm willing to go all the way down. Like when you write characters, you got to go all the way down with them.
Yeah.
So you're not writing shitty straw men and cackling villains twirling their mustaches. You got to have a point of view, right? For your protagonists and your antagonists. You can't have like wonderful heroes who do no wrong. If I can go all the way down with understanding of that, then maybe I will, through my humility and willingness to occupy that perspective, maybe I will have earned the right to figure out how to talk to that person and talk to that community in a way that they might think I have something that's worth listening to.
That's good.
Yeah.
We've brought it all the way around in this episode and we're over, but this has been great. I think went from comic books to abortion. I don't think that's ever happened in this show.
Yeah.
This episode may be brought to you by metaphor.com. I don't know. metaphor.com. There's been a bunch of great ones, though, right, Pete?
It's fantastic. I mean, look, you're just a walking ball of ideas that are fantastic. And just to prove the point that you are not afraid to search for that discomfort, apart from getting choked out by seals, I'm looking at a copy of The Bell Curve above your head. Absolutely not a book for a guy from San Francisco who's a hippie, no good liberal, right? I mean, but you were able to get in, and I'm positive you've read enough of that book to understand all of the work in there. And it is a thing like that goes in your quiver of 1,000 books that I'm looking at.
I think he's read them all too, because he used like ossified and confirmation bias. I don't know. I'm stealing that. I'm going to start doing that, like stealing.
But it's a fantastic conversation, and it's all about connecting the ground truth and the policy level things. And that person who works in that line, you know, a lot of times you just vote for not that. Just not that.
It's funny you bring up The Bell Curve, because I have two volumes of essays that are the defense or the reaction to The Bell Curve.
Right.
When I was an undergrad, Dick Hernstein was my professor of psychology. He's one of the co-authors with Charles Murray.
Yeah.
And in one of the greatest events, it's so funny that you signaled in on that.
Yeah.
It was at the Kennedy School in Cambridge, and Dick Hernstein died before The Bell Curve came out.
Right, yes.
Charles Murray was there to defend
it. The arrows, yeah.
Right. And so he was up there, and Stephen Jay Gould was debating him.
Uh-huh.
And before it started, you have big debate stage, the both sides really going at it, really, really impassioned, right? Stephen Jay Gould, you know, Jewish, not remotely a fan of any arguments that are made tying genetics to IQ.
Right.
And it was at the Kennedy Center, and Henry Louis Gates, who's a great African-American professor, came and did the introduction, and he said, this is where, you know, you can guess what his view was.
Yeah.
He said, this is where we dispel this in the light of day. I'm paraphrasing here and this.
Yeah.
And the Black Students Union and the Jewish Students Union stood up and walked out as soon as Murray took the stage. And I thought that was so interesting. And I went and sat in the front row.
Yeah.
And it was one of the greatest debates it's maybe
what
the highlight of my whole academic experience. It was like watching Inherit the Wind and having Gould animated and all the views and all the arguments out there. And I walked out of there thinking, you know, I feel much more solid in the ways this was aired. And if I talk about that, then I would be otherwise. And then I'd read the book, and then I went and got, there's two files that are sets of essays and, you know, in opposition from thinkers from all different varieties. And so it's a perfect example of an incredibly problematic, controversial, challenging topic that I actually spent a lot of time trying to 360 all the way around, because my natural inclination politically, you know, is not going to be in favor of a book like that.
Right.
But I wanted to make sure I saw and heard everything and made sure that in my
being informed so you can have an opinion.
Right. And that my opposition to it is earned. Right.
Yeah.
And that I understand it. So anyways, good point to end on.
Yeah.
Thank you, gentlemen. It's a pleasure to meet both
great,
of you.
Man. Lashana Tova, belated.
Thank you.
Man, what a great show, Pete.